Glad we're here today versus snow days. Snow days stink. But glad to see everyone's smiling face. Glad to be in the house of the Lord. Welcome everyone online if we have people online watching. So we'll open with a word of prayer and go into some praise and worship. Father God, we thank you for the opportunity to gather today. We thank you that we're in your house. We thank you that you're here, Lord. We welcome you, Holy Spirit. We just ask that you change us today, God. Move in this place. Move in this place in powerful ways, God. We pray for miracles today, God. We want to see your work done here today, Father. We thank you for this opportunity. We just ask that you are blessed by our praises, and we just welcome you here today, Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If you could stand. Seniors ministry meeting. So whoever would like to participate or even potentially lead, the pastor is planning to get a group together to organize and plan events and also cast a vision of what the ministry should look like. So if you'd like to attend that, visit just the meeting downstairs. Yeah, so downstairs at 1. As usual, Wednesday the 19th will be our prayer night. Just a reminder that Wednesdays have switched to 6 from 7, so we've moved Wednesday night service up an hour to 6 p.m. Also, we do have a 5th Sunday this month, so 30th will be a potluck. Bring a friend, bring a treat to pass. Just also a reminder for Sunday school this month. Right now, Lewis is teaching us on holiness, so very good teachings going on again. Just want to encourage everyone that can come to participate. Also, we do have pre-service prayer still at 9:30, which is a good time to just set the atmosphere for the service, ask the Lord to come, and just spend some time in prayer before we start everything. Pastor is still interested in doing a membership class for anyone that would like to participate. So if you would like to do that, just either send him an email or just send him a message and he will work with you to get that set up. So I think that's it. We have Carla.
Yep.
Carla, would you like to give your testimony?
Yeah.
Is that one working?
I don't know if that one's working.
It's been active.
I can go up there or sit down here. Doesn't matter.
Or I can even. That one's been acting funny, though.
Hello.
No. Oh, is it?
Hello.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, it's working.
Most of you know that I've been praying and believing for a service dog. I pick it up this afternoon at 5 p.m.
All right.
I didn't think it would happen this quickly. I sent the application in on Christmas night. And I got a call the Friday after Christmas, so that was pretty quick. And God, I was getting very impatient with God and said some horrible things. And God is good. And he showed me a scripture this morning. But when the kindness and the love of God, our Savior, toward man appeared, not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to his mercy, he saved us through the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us abundantly through Jesus Christ, our Savior, that having been justified by his grace, we should become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. This is a faithful saying, that these things I want you to affirm constantly, that those who have believed in God should be careful to maintain good works. These things are good and profitable to men. I started looking for silver linings in situations that didn't look so great. And I started looking for ways to help other people. And I started doing that with my neighbors and in my community where I live. And it turns things around real quickly when you take your eyes off of your need and help others. And I would like to encourage all of you to do that, even though there's hard times right now. I just came out of a 6-month stretch of homelessness, and God is faithful, because I never had to sleep out on the street. And it could have very well been that. I always had a mattress to lay on, thank God. He's faithful. I've never been hungry. I've never been without a roof over my head. But here's my home, folks. You all are my home. Thank God.
All right, thank you, Carla. Good testimony. I know she. I talked to her last night, and she asked me if she could give a testimony. I said, yes, you can give a testimony. But starting this month and from now on, we're actually going to, every third Sunday is going to be Testimony Sunday. So if you'd like to give a testimony, just shoot me an email, let me know, because we don't have time for everybody all the time. If we have 10 testimonies, that's a big chunk. But if you have a testimony, just shoot me an email or something. Let me know that you have a testimony, and you can come up here. And I want everybody to know your testimony, because I want everybody to be encouraged by what God's doing in your life. Because he's doing things in all of our lives. Sometimes we don't know, but when you get on the microphone and you just talk to people, talk to the congregation and say, God's doing this, God did this for me, it just encourages all of us, right?
Amen.
It does. It's just, it's a blessing, because it shows you that God's not dead. We know he's not dead, but sometimes we get weary when things go on in our life, and we're dealing with something, but God shows up. He doesn't, he'll never leave us or forsake us. So thank you, Carla. All right, just want to say hi today. I'm Pastor Kelly. People that are online, hello. I'd like to thank you for being here today. And I just want to start off, we do have a website. Go to our website, check us out on our website, www.lansingcalvaryag.org. And you can get on there, check us out, tell your friends and neighbors about us. We are a multicultural Bible-believing church. So, you know what? I know God has us here for a reason. We're here to impact Lansing. We're here to impact our neighborhoods. We're here to impact our families. So just tell them about us. Just tell, promote us. Just promote us. We wear a Lansing Calvary like a logo on our pants or our jackets. But today is the beginning of Missions Month. I don't know if everybody knew that, but today's the beginning of Missions Month. And we're going to focus on missions the entire month of January. And God put it into my heart to make January, each January, long as we're here, and we haven't been raptured, to make every January Missions Month, to celebrate our missionaries that we, just celebrate missions in general and our missionaries that we support. And he's put a desire in my heart to focus on missions, because missions is very important to the body believers. Missions does not mean overseas. Missions is where you are. It's your neighborhood. It's your family. It's your friends. So missions is very important. But before we go forward, I want to give you a picture If you don't know, if you've never seen a picture of our current mission, our current missions ministry at Lansing Calvary, we support 18 missionaries. How many of you knew that? Okay, we have a couple hands went up. We celebrate 18 missionaries, and that's a lot for a church our size. It's like having somebody eat a bunch of food for dinner. Like, can you eat all that? It's just incredible because we celebrate, we have 18 missionaries that we support. And the breakdown goes, we have 12 foreign missionaries over in different parts of in different countries. We have 5 US-based missionaries that are in America, and we have 1 missions training organization. So they train missionaries to go out into the field. Because you can't, just like the Army, they have to train you. You just don't go into the field and just shoot a gun and know how to shoot it and know how to fire it, right? So they train you. And our church, we have 18 missionaries, and our church pays $500 per month from the general fund to support missionaries. So $500. So that's, you know, that's, first of all, that's a lot for a lot of missionaries we support. That's a lot of our tithes and offerings that go to missionaries. And the general fund is what we use to pay our bills, our electric and our heat. Everybody loves heat, right? It feels good. I remember a couple months ago, we didn't have heat. It would feel like it was ice age in here. If it was a dinosaur, it would have just passed away, dropped. But so the general fund is what we use for ministry, our bills, and everything else that we do here. And it's basically like a checking account. Raise your hand if you have a checking account. You usually pay your groceries and everything with your checking account, your bills, your groceries, and everything else in between. But I've been praying about this for a while now, and God gave me a vision for missions. It's good when God gives you a vision, doesn't it? I'm saying we need to have a vision. So for 2022 and going forward, my vision is to transition from supporting our missionaries from the general fund to becoming self-supported by giving by monthly missions donations. So the goal is to be self-supported, so to have our missions pledges and missions donations to equate to $500 per month, so we will not have to take out of the general fund. Because when we take out of the general fund, that just causes us to be able to do less evangelism, less outreach, and less different things, right? So that's the goal right there. And you know, like I said, I've been praying for a couple months, and I sense God compelling me to begin this transition. And the way we're going to do this transition is by pledges. You guys with me? So we're in pledges. So before I talk about the pledges, I want to just talk about tithes and offerings to begin with. So tithing, you know, tithing is a commandment, right? It's a commandment that God's given us. One tenth of everything that you happen to lease, or God's letting you lease, God owns, and He's given that to you. But God requires and asks of us 10% of our income to go to God, right? Everything else, so everything else above your tithe, above that command, is offering, and after you pay your tithe, which I'm saying I hope everybody does, and I hope everybody's obedient, everything else is considered an offering. So offerings are anything above a tithe. So so technically, this, if you today, the pledges, the mission pledges, that would be part of an offering. I just don't want you to get mixed up with, you know, if I do this, I don't do that. If I do this, I don't do this. So offerings are number one. That's our number one thing. But I want to go back to our pledges. So today, everybody here is going to have an opportunity after prayer. Don't jump on anything. You shouldn't do anything. If somebody pressures you, a pastor pressures you, that's not a good pastor. Don't let anybody pressure you. I try not to pressure people. I don't like salespeople because they pressure you a lot. But today you're going to have an opportunity, and We have pledge cards for missions giving. And actually, could you pass these out right quick? I made quite a few right here, but they're not really cards, they're just paper. But we have these pledge papers, like you said, and basically they're just saying, you know, just after prayer and after consideration, I would like you just, you know, if God puts on your heart to be part of this missions pledge, I'd like you to, you know, do that. Just be obedient. That's all I'm saying. Be obedient is to me grand. But this pledge card says, in order to fulfill the Great Commission, Lansing Calvary partners with missionaries all over the world to spread the gospel. So we do. We partner with 17 missionaries and one missionary training organization. In partner with this commission, I commit to making the follow-up pledge to mission. So whatever God puts on your heart, you know, just go with it. Just do it. Do whatever you have to do. Do whatever God asks you to do. So the way we're going to use these pledge cards is we're going to tally up the pledges each week. So up on this, up here somewhere, we're going to have a pledge tally each week. And as we should have started this last week, but we had no church because of weather. But we're going to have a little meter, and we're going to start off after today or whenever we get pledge cards. We're going to start off, and we're going to have this little meter. It's going to go, you know, the goal is going to be $500. After that, we're going to go up and up until we see how we are doing weekly. So we'll see at the end of January, we'll see what God does. He's going to do something. I know he's already done something. He's already doing something. But, you know, as the pastor of this church, you know, I have a heart for people, and I have a heart for ministry, and I have a heart for missions. I know the Kings, Luce and Arlene's son, was a missionary. And as soon as they told me that, I remember it just I felt an instant connection with the son who I never met. It's just something about missions. It's something about, and it's not just about missions, it's about obedience. It's just, you know, the calling that God puts on each of our lives. You have a choice. You do it or you don't do it. It's pretty simple, right? But ever since Luce and Arlene told me about their son who was in missions, it just, you know, I just put an instant connection with him. But as we go deeper and wider as individuals and as a body, I want to see everyone and everybody continue to grow in our Christian walk. We talked about it downstairs today, about transformation. You know, transformation is really one of the things that God wants from us. He wants us to transform. If you're the same, if you were the same 10 years ago as you are today, I don't know if there's much transformation. He calls us for transformation. And one way to do this is by praying for increase and stepping out in faith, right? It's about stepping out in faith. Sometimes, you know, people don't like to do things that they can't, they don't feel comfortable with. Sometimes God just says, you know what, do it. Just walk out the water, Peter. Come to me. Don't look down, look at me. Keep your eyes focused on me. And what happened? When he kept his eyes focused on Jesus, he was okay. So he took his eyes off, he went down. But, so, stepping out in faith. So today, I already filled mine out today because I've been praying for it for a while and I have access to this right here. But today, my wife and I, and my whole family, because this impacts everybody, my family, we decided to pledge $100 to missions per month. And I'm telling you this from a framework of encouragement. I just want to encourage everybody to, you know, just to pray, first of all, to listen to God and just be obedient right here. So, pray about your finances and ask God if he wants you to give or not, because he might not want you to give the missions. He might say, you know, just do this or that. Just listen. I'm just saying, I'm a pastor of obedience. I'm a pastor of obedience. I just say, pray and obey. That's all you can do. And everything else, you know, if God wants you to give, do it. If he doesn't want you to do it, but it's between you and God. It's not between me and you. If you pray about it and God says don't do it or whatever, it's not gonna change like how I look at you. It doesn't matter to me. It's all about you. But in regards to our church budget, you know, our monthly missions, well, it's going to directly impact our general fund, which will directly impact our ability to do ministry. The more our missions can be fully funded, the more we'll have more finances and resources we will have to do ministry. We're going to be starting a new ministry third Friday, actually, the first missions, or the first seniors ministry meeting. And I want it to take off. I want it to work, right? I'm saying there's a lot of people that I heard that expressed some interest in it, and I want it to go. And I'm being into what God says, you know? Go do it. And in the Bible, it always talks about go. That means do it. It's an action. But ultimately, advancing God's kingdom should be our main purpose in life, right? It's what we do. It's what we get up for. We don't get up for our cheerios. We don't get up to drive our car. We get up every day because we have a purpose to advance the kingdom. And I just want to pray about that. I want to pray about this before we go forward into our sermon today. I just want to pray for it. If you could bow your heads. Dear God, I thank you for this opportunity today to tell the congregation and people online about missions, God. You put it into my heart to do this with missions, to transition from being fully supported by the general fund to supporting itself. And God, I just pray that everybody here, you would just, they're going to come to you. They're going to come and seek guidance to you. And God, just put on their heart what they should do. And God, I just pray that they're obedient, God, and that you speak to their heart, God. If you tell them to give a certain amount, God, I pray that they don't give anything less, anything more. They give what you say to give. And we thank you, God, for everything that you're doing here. And I pray for all the missionaries. In Jesus' name, amen. All right. So let's turn to the book of Matthew chapter 28. Matthew chapter 28. So Jesus had just been crucified and buried in a tomb. And the tomb was being guarded by Roman soldiers because the chief priests and Pharisees believed Jesus was not the Messiah. They actually called him a deceiver. Isn't that crazy? Some people call Jesus a deceiver. Well, I don't think that was good for him to call him a deceiver. But the reality is that the chief priests and Pharisees were the ones who had heart issues and were living in deception. It's sad when your heart is so twisted that you can't see the truth or accept the truth. And we have lots of people like that. People's hearts are so twisted, they're so off-centered that they can't see the truth or accept the truth. And the truth is, which the Pharisees and the chief priests didn't understand, that Jesus is the great high priest. He was the great high priest. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And John 3:35 says, the Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hand. So Jesus has all authority because God gave it to him. The chief priests and Pharisees could not accept this. They couldn't accept the fact that Jesus had authority. And some people can, some people that are walking on earth right now, they can't believe that Jesus has all authority. God gave it to them. God created, God promotes. God ordains. God commissions. God does what he wants to do. Regardless if you like it or you don't like it. All right, so we're going to start at Matthew chapter 28, verse 1. So now, after the Sabbath, as the first day of the week began to dawn, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary came to see the tomb. That's Mary, Jesus' mother. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it. That would have been a really good thing to see. Angel of the Lord descended from heaven, woo, and rolled back the stone from the door and sat on it, just like, hey. His countenance was like lightning, and his clothing as white as snow. And the guards shook for fear and became like dead men. I can picture that. I just can picture it. Just people shaking and just like acting like a bear was there. You know, like when a bear, like they said, when you see a bear in the wilderness, you just act like you're dead. Because they won't mess with it. I can see it kind of like that. But the angel answered and said to the woman, do not be afraid, for I know you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he is risen, as he said. The Bible says lots of things. And it's true. Come see the place where the Lord lay. And go quickly and tell his disciples that he has risen from the dead. And indeed, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. Behold, I have told you. So they went out quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to bring his disciples word. They're going to tell everybody that Jesus is alive. They just saw him. All right, verse 9 and 10. And as they went to tell his disciples, behold, Jesus met them, saying, rejoice. So they came and held him by the feet and worshiped. Then Jesus said to them, do not be afraid. Go and tell my brethren to go to Galilee, and there they will see me. Okay, he's giving them some more instructions. More instructions. All right. Verses 11 through 15 is where it gets kind of interesting right here. Now, while they were going, behold, some of the guard came into the city and reported to the chief priest all the things that had happened. So the chief priest, I'm saying, he's like the big honcho. When they had assembled with the elders and consulted together, they gave a large sum of money to the soldiers. So the chief priest. So they give a large sum of money to the soldiers. Verse 13, tell them his disciples came at night and stole him away while we slept. And if this comes to the governor's ears, we will appease him and make you secure. So they took the money and did as they were instructed. And this saying is commonly reported among the Jews until this day. You know, the thing about that is it's like the biblical scholars, the Pharisees, they knew the truth, but they were trying to hide the truth. They knew that Jesus was going to be resurrected, but they didn't want to hear that because their hearts were twisted. Their hearts were not calibrated correctly. And that's what happens when your heart's not calibrated correctly, you don't accept truth. You'll give somebody money so people are turned the other way. You'll do things to get people to not believe the truth because you know the truth and you just don't want other people to know the truth. All right. And this is our focus for today. Verse 16 to 20. Then the 11 disciples went away in Galilee to the mountain which Jesus had appointed for them. He told them, hey, go to this mountain. I'm going to be there. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. And Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, he said, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Amen. Jesus has all authority in heaven and on earth. And this is today's focus right here. Verse 19. Go. Everybody say, go. Okay, and this is our commandment that we're given right here. Every one of us right here is commissioned to do this. I don't care how old you are. I don't care. It doesn't make a difference how young you are, how old you are, you know, who you are, what your job is, whatever. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and the Holy Spirit. Turn to your neighbor right now and say, I want you to tell them, I want you to look straight in their eyes and say, we have a job to do. And I want you to also say this right here. I've been commissioned by God. I've been commissioned by God to make disciples. We've been commissioned by Jesus to make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son of the Holy Spirit. Verse 20, teaching them to observe all things that I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. The focus of today is going to be on verse 19. Lansing Calvary, in Lansing Calvary Online, we have a job to do. We've been commissioned. When I was writing this sermon, I look for synonyms, which are words that are the same as commission. And commission also means we've been certified. I want you to, after I say, when I say, I want you to say my food. Certified. Licensed. Sanctioned. Mandated. Tasked. Sorry. Warranted. Charged. Appointed. Assigned. And the last one, nominated. We've been all those things. We've all been given the green light. We've all been given the green light to do those, to make disciples. All of us have been given to the green light. Nobody in this room, nobody who's a Christian at another church or Mount Hope or in Africa, nobody has a yellow light or a red light. They all have a green light to make disciples. You are given a green light to make disciples at school. You're commissioned to make disciples in your neighborhood. We're all commissioned to make disciples at church, in our neighborhoods, at the grocery store, family, friends, everywhere. And if Jesus says we're supposed to do it, you know what? There's no option. Yes, God has given us choices, but you reap what you sow. If God says to do it, Jesus says to do it, the Holy Spirit says to do it, the Trinity says to do it, we do it. So we've been commissioned to make disciples. And today we're going to explore one of the most important aspects of being a Christian. This aspect rests on the reality of doing your part to fulfill the Great Commission. Doing your part. When you're fulfilling the Great Commission, don't worry about other people's part. Just worry about your part. What you're supposed to do. What God's spoken to you. Because I can't, you know what? If God says something to you, I'm glad, I'm happy about it that you listened, that you heard God. But you know what? Don't try to pull me into this relationship. You know, if God told me to do something specific, awesome. If he told you to do something specific, awesome. But do what you have to do. He gives people words. You know, sometimes a lot of times God gives words for you and not for everybody else. So we have to really understand that. But the title of today's sermon is titled More Than Pew Warmers. More Than Pew Warmers. And I loved it because I'm the type of person, I love the fact that he gave me this title here, More Than Pew Warmers. Because we're not pew warmers. We're not pew warmers. We're all called to make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And I'm going to pray right now. Bow your head. Dear God, I thank you for this message, God. I pray that it fires people's spirits up, God. It gets them burning inside, God. Cause that furnace inside to heat up and after that, radiate outside of their body, God. And everywhere we go, God, I pray that we remember this commission that you've given to us, God. And God, help us make disciples, God. Help us walk this out, God. Help us run our race, God. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. All right. So as followers of Jesus, we're called to be active in our faith. We're called to be active in our faith. And active faith is faith that requires movement and energy. And active faith can be classified as a faith that is, it can be classified as a verb. Verb. I like verbs. So a verb is a word that describes an action, state, or occurrence. So active faith requires action. It requires action. That's why the title is called More Than Pew Warmers, because it requires action. We're not called just to come to church every Sunday and every Wednesday and maybe a little bit in between and sit our butts on the pew and just kind of just sit there and take things in. We're called to be active. We're called to do things. Everybody can do something. That's the problem. That's the problem sometimes churches in America, we just don't do anything. We rather just go through the motions, come here, get a little bit of word in this right here, and just kind of just go home and watch TV. But we're called to be more than pew warmers. We're called to be changers. And we're called to change atmospheres, change situations, and to intercede for people and to do things. Amen. Can I get an amen, somebody?
Amen.
And Apostle Paul summed up active faith when he compared it to a race. And I love the fact that, you know, when I got here, that Dan, he talked about this race. He talked about this race, and it's kind of just become a part of who I am. It's been ingrained into me. And let's go to 2 Timothy 4:7. And Apostle Paul said, I have fought the good fight, and I finished the race. I have kept the faith. Apostle Paul was not a pew warmer in any sense. He was not a pew warmer. He was a faith fighter. Everybody say faith fighter. I'm a faith fighter. I'm not a pew warmer. I'm a faith fighter. I'm going out in God's behalf because I've been commissioned. He fought his whole life. And the funny thing about Paul, or I don't know if I should say funny, but the thing about Paul, he started off fighting Christians. He was starting off fighting Christians, and he ended fighting for Christianity. He ended fighting the thing that he was fighting against, he was fighting for. That's awesome. That's a testimony. But the thing about that I love about Paul, Apostle Paul, when he first started, but Apostle Paul, that he endured so much and kept on going. He dealt with a lot of things and he kept on going. You know what? Sometimes we break our fingernail and we don't want to come to church. Sometimes we stub our toe and be like, you know what? God, I can't make it, y'all. I can't do it. I can't do it, God. I'm going to stay home today. But Apostle Paul said, you know what? Apostle Paul wasn't like that. He wasn't like that. And so, you know what? I want to tell you some things that he went through. I want to tell you, and I know in other sermons I've said some of these things. He was beaten with rods. But he still would have came to church with a busted head. He was pelted with stones. One of them might have took his eye out, but he still came. He was shipwrecked. And he endured much more for the Great Commission. And many have asked why. Some people that are not, you know, Christians or don't know the Bible, you know, why would you go through all that stuff? Why would you get beaten with rods and pelted with stones and get shipwrecked? And many people ask, why do we go through things? Has that ever happened to you before? Has any of you have ever been asked, why do you go through that stuff? Why do you come to church? Why, and it doesn't have to be in a negative connotation, why are you so happy? I just talked to somebody the other day. They're like, why do you stay at church so long? Oh my gosh. I could not believe 35 minutes I'm out of here. Why do you do this? Why do you do this? The answer is because we're more than pew warmers. We've all been called to God's kingdom and we have a job to do. That's why. When you have a job to do, you can't, I'm saying, that's why there's no retirement in God's kingdom. You know what? You're a Christian. Maybe if you get saved when you're 10, you're still going to be called to do things at your last breath. Because we're called to be active. We have a commission. When you're commissioned, that commission doesn't expire or retire. But I want to go back to Matthew 28:19 right now. And this is, and like I said, this is the verse we're focusing on. It says, therefore, go, first of all, that's what it says, go. So that means go. So that means if go just means you got to be active. Because you can't go and sit down. You know, I know we have a family friend and the kid, his parents were like, you got to exercise. And he's just like, well, if I stick my head out the door, is that considered exercise? No, it's not considered exercise. You actually got to do something. But it says, go, therefore, make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son of the Holy Spirit. But in order to fully understand, and to understand it fully, we have to look at Matthew 28:18. So it says, and Jesus came and spoke to them, saying, all authority has been given to me in heaven and on earth. Jesus has been given all authority by God, who created everything, on heaven and on earth. So when you possess authority, you have the right to give orders, right? Just when you're a parent, I say take the trash out, right? And your kids are going to be like, okay, well, I guess I better do it because they have authority. They're my parents. But, you know, God, but authority, when you have authority, you have the right to give orders, to make decisions and enforce obedience. And Jesus was given authority in the heaven and on earth and thus has the green light to operate out of the framework. That's the framework, because if Jesus says, if Jesus, God said, you know what, whatever you say, son, they're going to do. Or they're, you know what, they have to respect that. You have authority, or authorita. But what we have to realize is that the words of Jesus in the Bible are not just nice suggestions or feel-good thoughts and quotes. They're not just nice suggestions. Well, you know what? Drink three glasses of water per day. If you do that, that'd be awesome. These aren't suggestions. These are commandments, and they're real. And we have to obey them, or we're breaking them. If you think about it, we're breaking them. If we say we're a Christian, we have no other option than to listen to what God says. We have to live by them every day, right? And that's the thing. That's the thing that we have to see, and see it into our spirits, and see it into our mind and our heart. We are called to do these things. It doesn't say in the Bible, well, you don't have to fulfill the commission if you've got arthritis in your knee, or if you have a headache, or if you have whatever. You know what? There's people going through things right now as we speak and stuff that are fulfilling the Great Commission, and it's awesome. It's encouraging. It's encouraging. It's awesome, as I'm saying. They're going through things, and their heart's still positioned towards God, and that's awesome. In Matthew, so we're going to go back to the Matthew 28, verse 19. So go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. We are to go. We are to go. And where should we go? What does it mean? Where do you go throughout the week? Name some places where you go out the week. Stores, Myers, Walmart, gas stations, doctor offices, church. And we go to stores, we go to stores, we go to restaurants, we go to gas stations, we go to parks, and we go places in our neighborhood. We go many places throughout the week. And the next says, make disciples. What is a disciple? You know, sometimes I know people, I've talked to people, and they think it's just like this big, extravagant, pompous word. It's not a very pompous word. A disciple is a follower of Jesus. That's all it is. It doesn't come with like gold dust and smoke machine, like smoke coming out of it. It's a follower of Jesus. And a disciple is one that has made Jesus Lord of their life and has chosen to make him Lord of their life, which means Lord of their ways. If you made Jesus Lord of your life, you made him Lord of your ways, of your thinking, of your words and deeds, and Lord of everything. And being a disciple is an active state of living. It has to do with learning. It has to do with learning, responding, seeking, and drawing close to the Trinity. It's active. You show me 10 Christians. You show me some Christians, I can tell you just by talking to them if they're growing or not, if they're learning, if they're responding, if they're seeking and drawing. Because if they're doing those things, they are maturing. If they're not, they're not maturing. They're just sitting there like a ball of mass. So we have to, you know, it's just like discipleship requires action, just like faith does. But one thing I do want to emphasize is that we're called to make disciples, which are different than converts. I've had somebody come in here and say, you know what, we could fill this whole church with people. But you know what? I want to make disciples. I don't want just people just coming here just saying, like, you know what, that spot is taken. We need to make disciples. Maybe that's one of the things with churches, you know, is that it's just like, you know, we have big churches get like a lot of praise, a lot of glory to them. But you know what? But are they making disciples? Are you just filling the church so you can be like, oh, look at my church. Look at me. I'm so awesome. My church is big, and then I got overflowing. I got people on the roof. They got to cut holes in there to look down. That's not what it's about. It's about making disciples. But we do have big churches in America that have fancy programs and ministries and glitter and fluff. That doesn't mean anything, because these churches can boast about numbers and revenue, but are they making disciples, or are they fine with having lots of converts? That's what it comes down to. I want healthy people, and I'm not saying you're going to start out healthy, but I want people to come here, I want to make disciples, and I want to get them healthy and transforming and transformation happening, because that's what's going to impact the kingdom. It's not going to be just, Christian number one, Christian number 203. It doesn't matter. Those are just converts. Anyone who makes Jesus Lord of their life is considered a convert, but Jesus said to make disciples. We do need a conversion, but we need to go past the conversion. If you're stuck on that day that you got saved 30 years from that day, I'm saying there's something wrong. But disciples are made. You make cakes, you make disciples, right? It's a process to making disciples. It takes something from you. It takes energy. You have to be active. You have to give something to yourself. You have to give up sometimes your resources, your time. Really? Right? It's not just something that just happens. A church, a disciple making church is not a church that just happens. You can't just use osmosis. You can't think it. You have to do it. And it takes action. It takes more than coming to church every Sunday or so. And if we're lucky, maybe Wednesday. Making disciples takes work that many don't want to do. They don't want to put in the work. They just want to have, it's just like getting a paycheck. Some of these young kids, they just want to get paid but not do the work. You know what? Nobody's going to pay you just because you look pretty. Nobody's going to pay you just because, nobody's going to give you money because you got good teeth. I'm saying you got fingernails that are shiny and polishy. It's not that. It takes work. And many people don't want to do it because it does take time. You know what? And this is kind of like, if you're doing kingdom work, you got to do the work of the kingdom. Does that make sense? I don't know. I just said it, but it just seems too simple. If you're going to do kingdom work, you got to do work of the kingdom. I guess it's really simple. But we're more than pew warmers. God has called us, each of us, into the game. And stop watching from the front row seats. He wants you to come into the game. Some people have been watching 20 years and stuff. It's time to get into the game. Put the shoulder pads on, the helmet on, put the jersey in, and start dribbling the ball, running the football, tackling it. You got to do that. It's time. The time is near. We've been watching this guy named... what's his name? Tiff Shuttlesworth. What a great name. Tiff Shuttlesworth. He's an AG guy, and we've been watching him. And Catherine, Catherine's been watching him a lot. And he deals a lot with eschatology, which is end times, Revelation. And his teaching is really good. It's phenomenal. And it's just like, it takes time for, Catherine to do that. She could just listen to Pandora, but she's taking time. She's listening. She's in the game. I don't want to be on the sidelines my whole life. I know you don't want to too. We have to get in the game. At some point in the time, you got to get in the game. You got to say to yourself, look into the mirror like that guy for Saturday Night Live. I'm good enough. I'm smart enough. And gosh darn it, I want to get in the game. You guys don't probably know who he is. But I'm saying, we got to get into the game and stop watching from the front row seats. And some of us, and part of this, some of us have to renew our concept of what Christianity really is. What is Christianity? It's more than just saying, well, I'm a follower of Jesus. That's just words. I know, like Dan always says, just words are words. But you know what? We want to see power. We want to see things happening. We want to see miracles. We can talk about miracles for 89 years. If we don't see one, man, we got to go after it more. We got to go after it. Signs and wonders. Go after them. Man. But our job is to tell the nations about Jesus and spread the gospel. Tell the nations. Our nations are not just, I'm not talking about Africa and China. I'm talking about our neighborhood could be considered a nation. Our friends and family could be considered a nation. You know, we gotta start spreading the gospel more than we spread gossip.
Amen.
We have to get our minds right and live focused lives on what really matters. It's about kingdom work. Because I would feel very bad if God just told me to do something and I didn't do it and I know that person died and they were not that Jesus wasn't the Lord of their life and I knew that they died. That would be really hard to take. That'd be really hard. I wouldn't really want to get out of bed, but you'd have to keep on going and do something. But what really matters is that we live our life every day for God, putting Him first in our life in every situation. And I know that's tough at times, but we have to put God in our life first. We have to put God first. And putting God first means we have to stay on mission each day. If you're just like me, sometimes you get off of mission, don't you? Some things happen sometimes, you know? Some things happen, and you get off of mission, but we got to stay on mission. Staying on mission is tough. That's why we have the body to help help lift us up and to encourage us, right? If you need something, I'm going to need something. I'm just going to let you know. I'll let you know. I'm going to need something from you eventually. And you're going to need something from me eventually. That's why the body is so important. Different parts, different functions, different needs, different wants. You cannot be a Christian and not have a body, a church body that you belong to. You know, just talking to some people here, you know, we have needs. And you know what? I can only pray so much, but when you have more than one person praying, man, there's a lot of power in that. It's power. But putting God first means we have to stay on mission each day. Each of us have been commissioned to fulfill the Great Commission. And it's not a suggestion. Jesus made it a command. So spread the good news. Make disciples. Pray for people. And baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. It may seem like a big task, but we're not doing this in our own power or in our own strength, because if we did, we'd get tired. How many of you get tired sometimes and get easily winded? Yeah, sometimes, you know, it's funny too that sometimes, like, you get up in the mornings and, like, you're only up for like 30 minutes and you do something like, man, I'm ready to go to bed. you know how I feel? You know, I'm just like, man, I still got 11 or 12 hours before I hit that pillow again. But you know what? That's why we don't do it in our own strength, though, because our strength is weak. We get tired. As we get older, our energy levels go down. But we have to depend on God. In Matthew 28:20, part B says, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Amen. Jesus is with us to the end of the age, to the end of our lives. He's with us. And this should give us confidence. It should give us confidence. If we run a race, Jesus is right there next to us, holding us up when he needs to hold us up. But even though we all work for Jesus, more importantly, we work with Jesus. We work with Him. So because of this, because we work for Jesus, and more importantly, we work with Jesus, we can have confidence of fulfilling the Great Commission and whatever else He asks of us. So we can have permission. If He asks us to do something that we don't think we can do, like teach something, like start a group or something, He's with us. We have nothing to fear, have no fear about, right? We have nothing to fear about. If Jesus is with us, He's going to be with us. A lot of times in the equation, Jesus versus us, whatever, it's us that we lack faith. We don't depend on God. We do it in our own power and we get tired and we want to quit. That's not what it should be like. Sometimes it is. But I want to give everybody three reasons why we can fulfill the Great Commission. Three reasons why we can fulfill the Great Commission, because we can't do it. Paul did it. Didn't he do it? Paul did it. You can do it. You can do it. You can do it. I can do it. Sometimes, you know, I'm just saying, I just want to be honest. Sometimes, you know what? Life is tough at times, however. Raise your hand if you ever just want to quit sometimes. Sometimes, what it's, I'm just saying, I think everybody wants to quit sometimes. It's natural. We're flesh. We have, we're fragile people. Some of us are strong. There's people that are like, can bench press 600 pounds, but they're still weak. But three reasons why we can fulfill the Great Commission. Number one, Jesus gives us protection. And we can fulfill the Great Commission because Jesus gives us protection because we're never out of his sight or his supervision. He protects us everywhere we go. We can walk in somewhere and he'll protect us. So that's why we don't have to walk around in fear. We don't have to be scared. If you believe that, say amen. So Jesus gives us protection. And that protection, sometimes we need more protection. Other times, you know, we don't feel like we need it, but we always need God. We always need Jesus' protection everywhere we go. Number two, the second reason why we can fulfill the Great Commission, Jesus gives us power. Because God has given him, all power, all authority over heaven and earth. So if Jesus gives us power, he's been given all the power. So we're tapping right from the main source. If you ever need power, if you ever need some more strength, just ask Jesus for more power. He has the power. He has authority. You're going to go right straight to the man. Jesus, I need some strength. I need some more power to get through the situation. He's going to give it to you. He's going to give it to you what you need. All right. And number three, the third reason why we can fulfill the Great Commission is because Jesus gives us peace. He gives us peace. Because he defeated sin and death, we have no reason to worry. If Jesus asked any one of us to go join the Live Dead group, which it's an organization that it's called Live Dead. I hope you raise your hand if you ever heard of it. And they basically go into places that are highly dangerous. I'm talking about like, you know what, you could get killed. And these people have peace because Jesus gave them the peace. You know what? Jesus said, you know what? I want you to go here. And you know what? And you know what they did? Instead of getting scared, instead of bowing down to fear, they said, you know what? I'm going to go. Because no matter what happens to me, I can walk in peace. No matter what happens to you, no matter what you're going through right now, Jesus, I'm saying you can have peace. You can have peace. You can have peace in your situation. You can have peace in your family. You can have peace at your job. And it doesn't matter what's going on. It doesn't matter because Jesus died so we could have peace. But I'm going to finish. I'm going to finish in a minute. But as I end today, I want everyone to read. You know what? It's kind of funny because downstairs, when Lewis was teaching, he said something about declaration. I can't remember what it was though. But it just caught my ear. It's just like, because I was gonna do it today. But as soon as he said declaration, my head just like flung, and I was just like, what is that? What's this talking about? But you know what? I want everyone right now to repeat this declaration after me, please. I feel like God put this in my heart to declare it. Because you know what? It's one thing to think it, but it's another thing to declare it. Speak it, right? And I want everybody to repeat after me, after I'm saying, just repeat after me. I am more than a pew warmer. I'm a follower of Jesus. Today I'm making an oath with Trinity to stay on mission, to fulfill the Great Commission. God use me. God direct me. God make my path clear. I was made to impact the world on your behalf. I choose to position my heart and eyes towards you, towards heaven, towards eternity. Amen. So I want to encourage everyone to continue running your race God has you in. We're all in different races. God has called each of us to different things, to different places, to different people. And, you know, I want to encourage you to keep seeking God and drawing close to him, which is, you know, it's transformation. I want to encourage everyone here to continue being transformed. You know, I talk to Catherine sometimes, you know, well, I talk to her every day, but we were talking, and we were just talking, and you know what, we see transformation in everybody, but we see it, some people, we see it more, but it's exciting. It's exciting. It's very pleasing to the spirit and to the soul. It feels very good to see that people are just transforming, and they're you know, they changed since I've been here. I've been here for a year, you know, as a full-time pastor, but they're changing, and that's something that, man, that's a testament to God, to his power, to you, to your obedience, to, you know, to your heart and to your mind. You know, I just want to keep on seeing that transformation. You know, I'm transforming too. You know, I feel like everybody is here, and I just want to encourage you to keep on doing it, because it's just good. And I know God is really, he's happy. He has a lot of joy about that. But I feel that God wants us, each of us, to go deeper than we've ever thought. You know, sometimes as humans, we cap things off. You know, we have a ceiling. We feel like we can only go past that ceiling. But in the name of God, I break that ceiling. We feel like we can only dig a hole so deep. In the name of God, I ask you, God, to dig deeper. I just want to encourage everybody to go where you haven't gone before. And it's, you know what? And I know there's been pastors here. There's been people here. You know what? And there's no diss towards them. But I just want to continue. I want to encourage you to go deeper than you've ever gone before. It's going to take work. It's going to take time. It's going to take some action. But you can do it, because I see it already. Catherine sees it already. But I do feel that 2022 is going to be a year of growth for Lansing Calvary. I don't know if it's going to be numbers-wise. I know it's going to be personal-wise, just individual-wise, but I don't know if it's going to be numbers-wise, but I feel like there's going to be growth, because we're going to be going deeper. We're going to be going, extending ourselves higher. And you're going to get stretched. I'm going to get stretched. I already feel like I am stretched. But I'm saying, God, let God stretch you and embrace it. Let him take you where he wants to take you. Not where you think you can, where you can handle. God's not going to break you. He's not going to rip your arms off and your leg and your head. But I'm saying, but he wants to take you places. He wants to stretch you. He wants to broaden you. Amen. Don't be scared of it if he asks you to teach something that you're not comfortable teaching. He asked me to teach Romans. It's tough. It's real tough. But I can't be scared of it, because I know God's with me. He's going to help me. I got to do my part, though, still. But I do sense lots of new beginnings and opportunities that have never been thought here and never been experienced here at Lansing Calvary. I'm telling you what I feel inside is that we're going to go somewhere that many of us, probably myself too, places that I just never envisioned and never thought of. If you're with me, say amen. Amen. If you want to go deeper and wider and higher, say amen. Amen. All right. I love hearing that and stuff, you know. And I just want to thank you. I just want to thank you for just, you know, being here today. So I'm just going to encourage you. I'm just going to be praying for you to continue. Continue just to, for God to use you and to transform you and to grow you deeper and wider and just help you get transformed to where he wants you to be. Because, you know, transformation never stops. God can use, he can use you at a young age, at an old age, and in between. So I just want to encourage everybody. All right, if you could bow your heads right now. My voice is raspy right now. All right, dear God, I thank you for this message, God. God, you know what? We are more than pew warmers, God. We are called. We've all been called on a commission. We've all been commissioned to fulfill the Great Commission, God. We've been given an order. We've been given the green light. And God, I just pray that everybody embraces that. They embrace that commandment, God. God, I pray that you give us people, just open our eyes and open our hearts, God, and bring us people into our neighborhoods, into our grocery shopping trips, God, that you and just give us a sign, a signal of like that what you want us to do. If you want us to pray for somebody, God, we will pray for them. If you want us to start a study here, God, we will start a study. If you tell us to partner with missions or whatever it may be, that we just do it, God. We just obey. And God, thank you for everything that you're doing in our lives, God. Thank you for everything that you're doing individually, as a church, God, and throughout our families, God. You're working on all of us. And we're becoming more like you each and every day. Right now, and I have to do this because it's just something God has told me to do from the beginning. If you were to die today, do you know where you're going? Basically, is Jesus the Lord of your life? The only way to go to heaven is through Jesus. You can't go to heaven because of your good works or your good looks or your nice car or how many people you baptize. You can only go to heaven through Jesus. You have to make him Lord of your life. If Jesus is not the Lord of your life, I'd like you to raise your hand right now. And this is for people that are online on Facebook watching right now. If this is you, I can't see you, but you know what? But it doesn't matter if I can't see you. You know, your prayers are heard from long distance. Jesus healed somebody and he wasn't in the same city. So if this is you and you want to make Jesus the Lord of your life, I'd like you to repeat these words after me. Dear God, I know that I'm a sinner. And I ask for forgiveness. I believe that you died for my sins and rose from the dead. Today I choose to turn from my sins and invite you to come into my life. Fill me with your spirit so I can know you, serve you, and follow you the rest of my life. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. All right, if this was you online, you made the best decision in your life. You just made Jesus the Lord of your life. And that's awesome because angels are rejoicing. God is happy. There's another person who's been saved from the pits of hell. Because hell is real. And it's hot and it's burning and it's not desirable. Nobody's getting tickets to go there. I want to encourage you to find a church. Maybe you have a family member or spouse or aunt or uncle or somebody that goes to a church. I encourage you to start going to that church so they can walk with you. Let them know your situation, that you were just saved and you want to walk with Jesus and you want to be discipled. That's what it is, discipleship. If you have no church, we would definitely love for you to come here at Lansing Calvary. You know what? We walk with people. We would love to disciple you. We would love to help you along and walk with you on your new journey in life. And you know what? You probably have lots of questions and you probably have a lot of things that you like answered. And we'll try to do the best we can. And we have people here that love you. They love each other. They love God. And if you come in here, we'll love you. And we'll treat you like family. That's what it is. All right. For the rest of us, if anybody here has any prayer needs, if you have anything that's going on right now in your life, I know there's things going on in people's lives, but if you have anything specific, you could come up here. We'll have somebody pray for you. And the altars are open also to anybody who would like to come and pray at the altar by yourself. If you just want to pray. So don't be shy, don't be bashful, come up here, you know. God knows it anyway, so it's fine. But for the rest of us right here, I just want to pray this benediction prayer. This is a prayer blessing for us as we go about our week. I do encourage people to come to a Roman study, man. It's pretty good. It's only good because not that I'm teaching it, just because we get so much interaction between people and people get to talk and we get to explain and we learn from each other. There's a lot of very smart people here. Not just intellectually, but just like, you know, God has done things. You know what? We're all smart because when God does something for you, that's something that a lot of times he has done for other people, and that makes you smart. That makes you smart. That's something that's priceless. Sharing like Carla shared today, her testimony, that's priceless. You can't go to school and get a degree for that. But I'd like to pray with you real quick before we end today's service. And you know what? I always pray for the congregation and for people that have specific needs. And you know what? Let's always be in the mindset of uplifting each other, because we all need to be uplifted every day. All right. May the Lord bless you and protect you this week. May the Lord smile on you and be gracious to you this week. May the Lord show you his favor and give you his peace this week. Dear God, I ask that you give us divine appointments, God. Match us up with people, match us up in situations, God, where, you know what, we weren't expecting it, but it happened. And God, give us opportunities to spread the good news, to tell people the good news, to tell people to pray for people, in their situations that may seem like it's like there's no hope, God. And God, we just thank you for everything that you're doing here at Lansing Calvary, God. I pray that you continue keeping your hand on us, on all of our heads, God, and all of our spirits, God, and guide us and take us where you want us to go, God. And God, we thank you for everything that you're doing. That's all we can do is thank you, but it's much more. We just want to live a lifestyle that's holy and righteous and pleasing to you. And we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.